At one level, why? Might be slightly mischievously because I grew up in South Africa. And lots of you far too young to immediately relate that possibly to the fact that there was apartheid. And if you have a mother who was a pacifist in Nazi Germany and a father who was in the Fleet Air Arm and you're mixed up with apartheid, you end up doing lots of thinking about justice and ethics in a way that I find remarkably absent very often in particularly English, but generally British life. And if we think about, I'm probably going to be a nightmare for the person who might be trying to do any filming. So let's think about some ethical theories. And so we've just had a brief discussion about Eudoxus. I'll come back to him. But I tend to say to people who say, oh, of course, nowadays we don't do that. Actually, you'll find probably the Greeks 2,500 years ago had already thought of it. They thought of a lot. And certainly one of the main bases of ethics comes from that time. I actually read Plato's Republic when I was 11 or 12 because I was living in what I knew was not an ideal society. And we were studying the Greeks at school, and it said Plato wrote the Republic to say what an ideal society was, so I thought, okay, let's have a look at it. Plato had a very high view of mathematicians. He had a very low view of poets, whereas I like both. But actually, the philosopher I resonate with more is Aristotle, Nicomachean Ethics, and he has this idea of what is now called virtue ethics. And he says, in order to behave well, and therefore to have a good life, good in all senses, you have to train yourself. Now, I hope most mathematicians will recognize that actually to be able to do maths well, you actually train yourself just as you do for music or sport. And then if you're going to behave well in all situations, it helps if you've practiced. If you're going to resist the temptation to embezzle money or to knock somebody over because they're in your way, it helps if you're used to consistently doing that. If we then drift forward a couple of thousand years, we get Kant. And Kant had another interesting way of saying, what kind of abstract framework can we set up that will capture a lot? So if you think of the beauty of mathematics, it's about the ability to abstract the essence of various different things. And then, because you've got the essence, you can apply it to all sorts of things, whether it's producing purple-coloured chairs or flying to the moon, right? We all know there's mathematics behind all of that. Kant wanted to come up with a general rule, and there are various versions of the general rule. Do things, behave in a way that it could become a rule for everybody. So if you say it's all right to lie, do the logical extrapolation of that, see where it gets you. If you don't like the answer, as mathematicians think of it as proof by contradiction, that behavior is not good because of where it leads you. So duty, doing what is right because it's right, and then you have the discussions of if you're never meant to lie, what do you do if somebody knocks on the door in the Netherlands, if a Nazi knocks on the door, World War II, and says, have you got any Jews in the house? Do you tell the truth or not? Okay, there is the story, of course, from Corrie ten Boom, that indeed this happened. They had Jews in the house. A Nazi soldier knocked on the door and said, have you got any Jews in the house? And her sister, who believed in telling the truth, said yes. And the Nazi assumed it must be a joke because he didn't expect anybody to give an honest answer and walked off. So life is full of interesting things. Then, of course, you get to the stage where people start saying, well, what about the consequences of your action? You might be free to do what you like, but you should think about what the implications for other people are. So if we want to say we're going to redefine marriage to include homosexual marriage, should we think about the consequences? If we're going to say girls should not have an education, should have an education, what are the consequences? And then you come on to utility. So this is obviously where the statisticians sort of gets a bit excited because you then get the idea that you don't just say, think about the consequences, which is a perfectly sensible thing to do, you say, and try to do some mathematics on them. So utilitarian is basically saying, if I've got a choice between two options, I should try to maximize benefit. Do what you can to maximize happiness for the greatest number of people. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is when John Stuart Mill wrote that, he did have an assumption that you already had an existing morality to which you were adding utility. If you step back and go for a purely utilitarian calculation, you do things like saying, oh, well, you know, if we chop you up and give your organs to all sorts of people who need organ transplants, then an amount of happiness might be increased because, you know, who cares about you? So you need that. Then, of course, in more recent years, the feminists have felt that, well, some of the extreme versions are logic and maths is masculine, and therefore, if you're a woman and a mathematician, you're a traitor. And yes, I have come across that one quite frequently. And I see there are two other people in the room who might have had a similar, two or three other people who might have had a similar experience. And the feminists have said, well, what about the ethics of care? What about thinking not just of the individual? And actually, an awful lot of these, although they talk about society, they talk about ethics in terms of the individual. And for most mathematicians, that's actually probably a natural way of thinking about it. The feminists are saying we should be thinking in broader terms about society and so on. And certainly when I was reading quite a lot of ethics, by various of the books, I did land up getting the feeling that these were plenty of men who were able to theorize because they'd forgotten there was somebody getting the food, cooking it, cleaning the house, cleaning their clothes and looking after them, i.e. women. So people who say, you know, Rousseau was wonderful, don't often spot that he said, I might have got Rousseau modeled up, but I think it was Rousseau who said, girls should only be given sufficient education to enable them to act as effective servants for men. But of course we hail him as a hero because he was a libertarian. I tend to like to wind feminists up, or some groups of feminists up, by pointing out that actually the ethics of care is not a 20th century phenomenon. It in fact goes back to probably most conspicuously the Hebrews, Jews. Their ethics is entirely based on the concept of love and reciprocity. It's useful to think about those things. I think when I'm considering situations, I quite often sort of mix and match. I wouldn't say I'm really a purebred one of those. My natural inclination would be to the virtue and the care, that it is important always to train yourself and other people around you to think about what is good, what is the right decision, and get in the habit of doing the right thing all the time, so that when you're under pressure, you will by default choose the right thing. My pet hates ignorance of, we don't really need to know it. You know, it's just what you feel like. You just do what you think is best, whatever feels right, without any attempt to apply the same degree of critical thinking to everyday life as one applies to, say, mathematics. My other pet hate is that the USA, well, I have this theory that both people from the USA and social scientists have to take a solemn vow of ignorance and to believe that the world began in 1800. Because very often if you go to talks, they say, of course, until the 19th century, nobody did this. And I'm sort of going, Aristotle, anyone? Or so on. And the US have come up with, somebody looked at the theories and came up and said, well, this can all be summarized by the importance of autonomy, beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice. As far as I'm concerned, the autonomy, that one of the most important things is that you should be free to make your own decisions without interference, because I'm a medical statistician, I find it particularly irksome. Because if you want to be free to decide whether to have, if you've got breast cancer, to have radical mastectomy or lumpectomy or radiotherapy, you are only free to make that choice if you live in a society which has an educational system which delivers nurses, radiologists, builders who build hospitals, doctors, and so on. And to then say, oh, you're upsetting my autonomy I just like, I don't relate well to something that seems to think of ourselves as little units that have no connection with everybody else, right? Don't ask for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for you, because no man or woman is an island. Okay, so maths. Now, what does the AMS ethical guidelines have to say? Well, they would certainly be quite keen that Eudoxus got credit for the research he did and that nobody else claimed it. And they have four headings. But these are ethical guidelines for the focus of the American Mathematical Society, the furtherance of the interests of mathematical scholarship and research. So the first bit is the concerns about plagiarism and accuracy and honesty. There's a social responsibility of mathematicians, the major bit of which is don't delay refereeing a paper so that your candidate gets a job and the other person doesn't, etc. All of that. So it's quite closely focused on that. Education and the granting of degrees. So there's a concern there about the standards of different institutions, which I think we could all share. And then it's, again, about accuracy of publication and so on. And they say, and I entirely sympathise with this, these are guidelines, they're not a set of rules, they're guidelines, they're things you might think about. And in fact, it recognises that it doesn't really have any power. It can pontificate, right? Just as I'm pontificating, and you can all ignore me. And it can't substitute individual responsibility for individual responsibility or for the responsibility of the mathematical community at large. And I think that's true and that's important, but not many people seem to make that leap from that to the WannaCry, the ransomware, to the things that are possible in terms of spying, in terms of rockets, nuclear work, etc., because of mathematics. But do you really need to know any ethics? Well, I would hope as mathematicians you can look at a graph. Okay? So I've made it as large as I can. It is in the public domain. It's on Sheffield University's website. Does AMS have anything to say about that? Well, yes, it does. Has something to say under social responsibility when mathematical work may affect the public health, safety, or general welfare. It is the responsibility of mathematicians to disclose the implications of their work to their employers and to the public if necessary.
What do they mean by if necessary?
Good point. I wouldn't have put in the if necessary. I would have put a full stop there, yeah. Personally. But also I've italicized their work. Is this a communal? Is it I have to explain my work, or when I see a graph like that which is not my work, I have to comment on it? And how many mathematicians would relate to that? Well, there is a group of people who do relate to it quite well, and I'll leave open the question of whether some of the debates about whether they're mathematicians. So I've certainly had some of my esteemed colleagues suggesting that anybody who does probability or statistics is obviously not a mathematician or an academic and not worth having. Said in a public meeting to EPSRC. But statistics, I think, is part of mathematical science, and it's the part of mathematical science that perhaps has put most effort into discussing ethics. There are lots of statistical societies. The big international ones are the International Statistics Institute, the International Biometrics Society, and then there are regional ones, the American Statistical Association, the Royal Statistical Society, and so on. Now, two of those offer professional status. I don't think there is a professional status for mathematics, which is why AMS says they can do nothing to enforce the code. But actually, the Royal Statistical Society is the person who certifies statisticians for Europe, the body. And therefore, if there is misconduct, You could be thrown out. Equally, of course, you can play it the other way, and you can say to a group of people, for example, I have to state that the work that you've done is seriously misleading, and my professional body requires me to say this to you. Yes, it made them very unhappy when I told them their work was seriously misleading. Why has professional status developed in stats? Well, statistics, I'm not, it's great for the historian, and I hope we'll come back on this later. I'm not claiming the only two sources of development of statistics are these two things, but they are two very important areas. One is states' interests in defence, health, economy, and tax. So where do you first hear of censuses? So deferred to historians, but there's an early census in, I think it's about the book of Deuteronomy, and the census is there because, no, maybe it's a bit later than that, the census is there because the king, I think, at the time, wants to know how many fighting men he's got. Okay? And you'll find a lot of census. Caesar goes for a census about 2,000 years ago, probably to find out what tax he ought to be getting, as well as what how many soldiers he can get. The Prussian state is supposedly where you get the word statistics from, because they started recording information. All of that is about data collection and understanding. Of course, the other important part, the essential complement to the data, comes from games of chance. How do we think about probability? How might we understand and tame uncertainty? And so statistics comes from the collection of those two things. You've got to collect the data, you've got to analyse it, and then, ideally, you've got to try to communicate it. And you need the probability of statistical theory. And that means that statisticians have had a fairly good chance to get involved in quite a lot of different areas, and they do typically tend to be doing things which have a much more immediate impact. Design of experiments in order to improve your beer, for example. If you realise that's the origins of some of the statistics, and to improve crops, health, and so on. Health was obviously one of the ones where you can get quite a lot of leverage, but official statistics is also really important. We've got the Sustainable Development Goals, great. Have you ever stopped to think about how we know what progress is being made? And how much pressure you might put on somebody if you're your bank balance doesn't look like it should do and you're a country like Greece or Venezuela. Those of you who might not have read that, and the senior statistician in Venezuela was fired and had court cases brought against her repeatedly, and in fact the senior official statistician in Greece likewise, because he reported honestly, but in both cases they reported honestly the state of the economy. I suppose Venezuela and Greece were relatively civilized because they didn't just shoot them, they merely prosecuted them. So I think one of the best ways of thinking about mathematical, statistical, professional ethics is actually the International Statistics Institute Declaration on Professional Ethics. Because I came to this from medical ethics, where you get these very prescriptive rules. And actually, I think this is the most helpful code I've seen. I strongly recommend you go away and look it up and read it. I've also looked at quite a number of other codes in the social sciences, and you can basically see they all pretty much reach back to this kind of division. And one of the points that's made is, actually, as a statistician, well, you're a person, you know. Mathematicians can think we don't need ethics because we just sit in isolation and do maths, and so it doesn't affect anything else. The statistician's code says, you have got obligations to four groups of people: to society in general, to funders and employers, to your subjects, and to your colleagues. So let's think about that. What obligations do we have to society? Well, there will be conflicting interests. You've got to consider who wants information and who might not want information. Okay, for us, an obvious thing is information about what websites people are accessing. Are they going on to Amazon and looking up, you know, whatever the comment was, looking up TNT and find, you know, people who bought this also bought nails, etc., to make a bomb. What websites are people going on to? Do we want to check whether members of parliament or school teachers are accessing child pornography? So you've got this privacy versus society conflict. Classic one for me, because I'll be appearing in court in December as an expert witness, is how do you tell when you put in somebody's hip replacement or new heart pacemaker or so on, how do you tell that it works? How do you tell that a new drug works? That again, you've got a set of conflicting questions. There's a very strong emphasis against guarding or against the misuse and misinterpretation of statistics. I mean, we all know that people quite often, if you say you're a mathematician, they go, ooh, I never liked sums. And it sort of implies, so I might not like you either. But of course, statistics, yeah, what comment do we get? Lies, damn lies, statistics, right? I have some wicked responses to that. But it's very important. You get an awful lot of very poor stuff out there. The media coverage of the alleged deficit of the university superannuation scheme is a good case in point. All sorts of numbers have been bandied about, according to whether people have read percentages as billions or vice versa. And you may think I'm joking, but I remember a talk from a statistician in the House of Commons library, and he said to us, so many MPs that at some stage in their career sidled up to him and said, I'm on the select committee, and so I just wanted to check, if somebody talks about 10% of 300,000, is that 3,000 or 300? If you, the discussion of a minimum wage, which they were trying to tie to the average, is another good example. Look at MPs trying to understand the difference between a mean and a median. So the other obligation is a very outward-looking obligation. You should be extending your statistics for maximum benefit. So, for example, if you get a research grant and you do some work on cerebral palsy, you might remember that there are actually people with cerebral palsy in their families who might like to have access to those results in a readable form, not just your technical papers. Again, that may be a bit more difficult in pure mathematics. I'm not suggesting these things can just generalize across. And then, of course, we always work with really quite difficult problems, right? The great thing about pure maths is it's pure, right? You don't, if you don't know something, you don't know it, and you can actually come down to a final set of conclusions. Whereas once you're getting more towards applied and stats, you might try to be as honest as you can, but you may simply be limited. You may simply not know about everybody who had a metal on metal hip replacement or something. So you should need to be transparent. The pension fund, again, said that they're aiming for openness and transparency. So why, when there was a petition of 1,700 people saying, could we please see details of your methods, did they say, oh, no, we didn't mean that? Sam Marsh from Sheffield has pursued that. What about funders and employers, right? If you're a statistician who's done jobbing statistics, particularly in medicine, you will have had somebody coming along and saying, here are my results, find something significant. Uh-huh. You go, no. All they say, design a study to prove that the calculations we've done are correct. Or can you collect data to demonstrate such and such, right? The answer is no. Yes. You have to set your boundaries so that you say, no, I'm not going to do that. My responsibility, depending where you are, my responsibility might be to collect the data and analyze it and provide these conclusions. Or it might be that my responsibility in a legal case will be, I will read the documents you give me, I will not read any other documents. Therefore, I will not make a statement as to whether those are correct or incorrect, right? If you're an experienced statistician, you say that because you know damn well if you looked at the rest of it, you'd find more mistakes. Not that it was cynical. So you have to be clear about what is your role and your responsibility and what will you do. Colleagues of mine, I've got two PhD students who work in pharmaceutical, former PhD students who work in the pharmaceutical industry. They get very frustrated at being blamed and assumed to be corrupt. Right? If you actually trace through the studies where there have been misrepresentations, you will typically find it's not the statisticians. The statisticians will have been objecting. There'll be other people who've been, marketing people who've been misrepresenting it. Also, there may be different ways of tackling a problem, and they may not give the same answer. And you may well have to say, look, if you assume this, you will get this answer. If you assume that, you'll get that answer. If you assume independence, we can give you a particular scenario, but we don't think things are independent. The other fun bit you have, of course, is getting more and more interesting, is the data you get. It's more and more interesting because people put an awful lot of stuff out in the public domain. I mean, I do not regard my date of birth as secret. I'm well aware that it's, don't particularly know how, but it's out in the public domain. But if anybody had a medical study on me, they wouldn't be allowed to have my date of birth. And you have this irony that you even have people who on this modern thing that I've never touched called Facebook, and you put up dates of birth and all sorts of things. And you have this irony that if you're doing a health study, you're not allowed that information, although it's sitting there in the ether. You can't give away the data. There is a lot of good work done on how do you make census data available to people without revealing identity. But you certainly should say what your methods are. I find that the colleagues one interesting because couple of medical cases where they were so busy defending their profession that they destroyed it. And again, you all look very, not all, most of you look very young. I'm thinking of the case, for example, pediatric surgery in Bristol, where they were had a very high death rate, much higher than elsewhere, but nobody wanted to report it because nobody wanted to criticize a fellow medic. Now the trouble is, of course, once that's discovered, you can have substantial damage to the entire profession. And so one of your responsibilities as mathematicians is to other mathematicians is that if you behave badly, I'm not saying what behaving badly might mean, you can actually damage your whole profession. That's much more easily done in statistics. We already have a big problem with the reputation of statistics. And if we have a colleague, and I can certainly think of in 2000 with the US election, I don't think the statisticians who did the work on that did a particularly good job. I've certainly come across some other things in my expert witness work. And of course, if you make a mistake in that, you damage the profession. And therefore, you should be transparent about your methods. You should be willing to be criticized. By the way, mathematicians, we're really odd, right? We actually accept criticism and we'll say things like, that's wrong. If you're like me and you work across disciplines and a social scientist says something and you say, that's wrong, they go berserk. They say, how can you say that? It's like, well, sorry, when you said made this statement, it is simply false, right? So we've got a strength in that we're open to criticism, but we do need to be aware that it is important to recognize the possibility you're wrong. Know your own and your collaborators' ethics. Well, of course, a lot of statisticians are working in different disciplines, so I have to know the various medical codes. Other people have to know the psychologists' or sociologists' codes. If you're in official statistics, you can potentially face a lot of challenges. And then you've got to try to give a really good summary of what you've done, and that's incredibly hard. And what about your subjects? Well, of course, subjects are not necessarily people. There might be an entire household, but there might also be a corporation. And one of the campaigns that the Royal Statistical Society has successfully managed with the recent election is to stop pre-release of official statistics to the government. You might say, well, why would that matter? Well, you start with two things, right? There's the obvious one. You've got to get a spin the story, try to sort of, you know, distract people from what's actually showing about the economy or unemployment or whatever. But the other problem is investments and shares and buying and selling. And basically the reason we managed to get a change on that is you could show that there were things being changed that reflected knowledge or statistics that weren't yet in the public domain. And that's affecting corporations and affecting their profits, and of course affecting their profits affects people employed by them. So I'm not just thinking about people getting money out of it, I'm thinking about the fact of employment. One of the most difficult things is this whole idea of informed consent. If you work in medicine, you will find that almost everybody reduces the entirety of ethics to informed consent. Actually, there's an awful lot more going on than that. But what do we mean by that? Okay, so I've just broken my arm. I didn't actually, it was 18 years ago. I've broken my arm. I've realized I'm not in a fit state to walk to the hospital. The guy who had the head-on collision with me, he's called an ambulance. Da-da-da. And then I get asked, do you want to be in a trial? Well, I didn't. In fact, I asked whether there was a trial and the surgeon looked blank. But what sort of consent might I want to give? And what if I found unconscious? Or, as one of my colleagues said, imagine a trial of a woman in the third stage of labour and asking her to give informed consent. Well, I don't suspect that nobody in this room is qualified to comment on that. What do you want to know? Well, personally, what most medical statisticians want to know is, was it properly designed? In other words, who's funding it? Because we know something about the people who've done the rigour of it. You know, is there a proper data monitoring committee? Frankly, given a choice, I'd rather be in a trial than not. And that is the primary thing I'm interested in. Is it well designed? Forget the details. But nowadays, of course, there's a concern of giving people more and more information. The net result that quite a lot of them go, I don't want anything to do with it. The trouble is that on average, you do better within a clinical trial than not. So by pushing more and more information to people, you're actually pushing them towards the worst option. Life is full of little irons. Then there's also the question of who should be allowed to get access to people. If you want to vaccinate children, obviously you're going to think about their parents. If you want to do something for people living in a care home with dementia, who gets there? And the ISI is very realistic, but it says informed consent is not the only thing, but it is important. It's part of treating other people as people and not doing what we're often accused of doing, just thinking of the person as numbers. They are actually people, they do have an interest in what's happening. One of the other comments that's quite shrewd in this, and I think it is an important point, is that even if the people you're working with are giving you informed consent, you're not actually doing anything at the moment that affects them. If you draw a conclusion about a group of people, it's going to affect a lot of other people. Yeah. There's a book called The Mismeasurement of Man about IQ testing, quite an old book. But part of the IQ testing was tested on, certainly one of the groups might have been Lithuanian Jews, coming over to the US seeking entry. And they've given the IQ tests in English. Now, I know how well I would do an IQ test in Lithuanian, really badly. So they, not surprisingly, didn't do very well. And then, of course, that was used to make generalizations about that whole population.
Yeah.
Okay. Even if it had been accurate, there's questions of whether it should be made about the whole population. And, you know, it's a really interesting question. What is the balance of finding out the truth? So I gave the example of, you know, you should always tell the truth as a classic for Kant, you know, you should not lie. Can we make this a universal rule? But of course now we're quite often faced with something different. I'll give you a couple of examples of that about what is legitimate about finding out about the truth. One must go back to early 70s in South Africa, where somebody got hold of the court records, which were all public judgments, and collected the data on whites being murdered by blacks and blacks being murdered by whites, and what sentences were given. Okay, the same thing's been run in the US. Now, in South Africa, he was convicted of a crime, bringing the judiciary into disrepute. All he'd done was collected information. The modern equivalent is looking at, for example, in Switzerland, looking at the nationality of rapists as a proportion of the nationalities in the country. It goes down very badly if you collect the data. And it's one of the reasons for that, I think. So when I was listening to debates, and obviously 70s and 80s, there was still a lot more difference between the way women and men were treated than there are now. So you're still in the 70s, you're getting women paid, doing the same job as a man, getting paid half the rate because she's a woman. There were these debates. And I used to find it interesting when people having these discussions to translate the discussion, once I was in the UK, back into the South African context. What people meant about equality and difference. And actually, I think mathematicians are probably uniquely well qualified to get the concept of equivalence classes without identity. There are circumstances in which you want to treat people as equivalent. When somebody has written an exam paper, you want to mark what the person has written. You don't want to say, well, it's a woman, so it can't possibly be good. On the other hand, if you're wanting to prescribe drugs, you may very well want to know, is this a man or a woman, for a whole lot of reasons. And as I say, I think mathematicians, you know, we can happily work with modulus. Okay, modulo 3, I can't tell the difference between 36 and 333, and we have no problem with that, we can do it. I think if you observe, all of us, and I include myself in this, it's actually a lot more difficult to do that on a human scale, to say, in this circumstance, it doesn't matter whether it's male or female. It doesn't matter whether this person is old or young, whether this person can or can't walk. And our generalizations can have quite a substantial impact on the basis of that. So just to say a little bit about the difference I found, and I'm not going to go too great length, but most people would expect the medical profession to have a code of ethics. There are the Hippocratic writings, which are extremely good fun if you've got a friend who's a historian of medicine and has looked into it. But people expect medical people to have ethics. And when I've looked at the codes, one of the things I found most interesting, as a contrast to the code for the statistical ethics, is although they make token references to community, almost everything is predicated on only two people, a doctor and a patient. And you must give your patient the best treatment. There's no question about how could you ever have found out about what best is? What optimality criteria are you using? Any sort of applied mathematician, statistician, if somebody says you've got to find the best solution to this problem, you may well think, which meaning of best? We're used to the fact that, you know, we've got a unique ordering in one dimension, but in two dimensions, if you want to say what's the largest, we've got options, we have to think. On the whole, in medicine, they're not that good at that. They tend to come back down to two people. And the Nuremberg Code, of course, came about because of abuse of people in Nazi Germany. There isn't a Nagasaki Code in Japan. The Japanese did very similar things to the Chinese and other nations they invaded in World War II. However, the difference was that Berlin was reached by the Russians, the French, the Brits, and the US. Only the US went to Japan, and therefore they said, you give us the data and we won't prosecute. The Brits didn't like that idea I don't think the Russians did either. So we had a code. It's actually quite a sensible code, if you think about it. We've got this consent and no delegation of responsibility. You can't say, I'm only acting under orders. Although, frankly, my experiences as on a board of directors makes me realise why it was so easy for the Nazis to get into power. People are remarkably keen to say, do you think somebody else will take the responsibility? You've got to be able to yield fruitful results. You've got to have adequate background knowledge. You don't want suffering and risk and importance. You can see these are all things that are indeed important, but they're ideal levers for statisticians, because we can do this stuff. Balance of risk and importance, qualified and so on. And that's the reason why there are a lot of medical statisticians, because about 40 years ago, my predecessors got their claws in and they started getting onto research committees and ethics committees and saying, badly designed research is unethical. And that had a major effect on this. And it's fed back in other ways to people being quite aware that getting your sums right is very important. Mathematicians might or might not want to take responsibility for the crash, the stock exchange crash and so on. Might or might not want to take responsibility for a lot of the decisions about funding of things. The real irony as well about the Nuremberg Code is that actually in about 1900 there was a country in the world that already had a code for medical experiments and medical data which required informed consent of the patients. Which country?
Prussia.
I think it was Germany by that stage, but yeah, Prussia. So the country where these things happened already actually had in law a code which said you shouldn't do this. So, the other medical codes are there, but I'll stop at that point because it comes back to what the AMS said. You can't force people to take responsibility. It's up to you, all of you, to learn what you can and to think, can I just assume what I'm doing is neutral? Or isn't it? If it's not neutral, what might I think about? Maybe today it has no impact, but maybe if I think like Kant, what happens if this generalizes up? How does that affect everybody? You know, can I expect everybody else to behave in this way? If it comes to expecting everybody to be logical, probably it would be lovely if they were. I guess Dickens and Hard Times might query that. But in the end, it's up to you to examine yourself, and I'll come back to Aristotle with the idea that a good life is one that is intellectually inquiring to the best of your ability and makes a habit of good thought and good conduct. And I can commend that to mathematicians as much as everybody else. Thanks for listening.
So before we move to questions, just so that we are recording this, so anyone who doesn't want to be recorded, either don't have to ask a question or write it down on a piece of paper and then we can read it out to Jane afterwards. So do we have any questions for Jane?
Well, actually, there are three points arising out of what you did which I'd like to raise. Can I do them all at once? Or?
But you'll do one and then we'll go to someone else, then one and then
okay, right. Wait, you talked about the emergence of probability as the tool for the study of random events, and there's this very interesting origin of the concept of expectation, which arose at gambling tables, where, you know, a card game would have to be stopped because, say, the innkeeper said we're shutting down now. So how should we divide what's left over in the stakes according to the probability that different individuals will win? And then they got into this division of the stakes according to the probability, in other words, according to the expectation in the mathematical sense.
Yeah, that's interesting.
But the interesting counterpart to that is, if they know how to calculate probabilities, all they need to do is to divide the outside of a roulette wheel in the corresponding proportions and...
Do one throw.
Do one throw. Which is a simulation solution.
Very nice, yes. That's interesting. I hadn't connected the development of the probability theory with that link to justice, the fair division.
Yeah.
I'd always thought of gaming as simply people trying to get their own advantage.
Well, that was sort of the origin of what probability theory, in fact. So, I'll shut up on that one.
Do we have another question? Yes.
So you mentioned that the general public does have at least some understanding of the sort of subtleties that go into statistics. The fact that assumptions can change the outcomes, even if they aren't fully aware of it, they sort of have some idea of that. But it seems that people don't really have the same sort of understanding of maths, that assumptions are very important. When they see that something's being mathematically proven, they're happy to accept that that's true and that they couldn't question it. Why do you think that there's this difference, and what could you do about it?
I think probably the difference is that it's quite easy to illustrate the effect of the assumptions, and the easiest one is probably representative sample. If we assume that by asking the three students left in the lecture theatre at the end of a 10-week course out of the 300, what they think of it, it's not difficult to show the importance of assumptions. Whereas with mathematics, typically where that kind of assumption matters is only interesting in much more technical things. So, you're getting into tropical arithmetic or something like that. And I think, put it this way, I would find it more difficult to come up with an example off the top of my head of the importance of assumptions in mathematics than for stats. Stats would to me be pretty easy to come up with lots of things. I think with mathematics, a lot of the mathematics that's available to most people is the stuff where if you start questioning the assumptions, again, you need quite a lot of maturity because it's the assumptions of arithmetic that...
Yeah.
So I think that's why you get that big division. And that's why I have some sympathy with mathematicians thinking we don't immediately hit ethics, whereas any statistician sort of falls over it as soon as they start.
In your talk, you mentioned that a statistician or mathematician working for a company, I'd say, if you assume this, then you get this conclusion. If you assume this, at this conclusion, it might sound like you're trying to be impartial there, but you're giving motivation to the company to say, this assumption means you have a nice conclusion. This assumption means you have a maybe not so nice conclusion. Which assumption do you want?
Yeah.
Well, I want the one that's all shiny and great.
Yeah, I mean,
there
is an art form to trying to communicate effectively, just as you would with. So obviously, one of the things you do get as a medical statistician, people coming saying, my aunt or my sister or sometimes I have had this diagnosis and I've got the choice of these treatments and what should I do? and again, it's not necessarily easy to do that, to elicit what's happening. But with the company, you could say, if we assume this, you're in profit. If we assume that, you're in deficit. You should only be introducing the assumptions at the point where there's some genuine basis for having different assumptions and being able to justify the assumptions. And so for example, in my pet example, until the last year or so, the scheme actuary would always, when asked, why have you assumed that, if you think of this, the response to this, why have you done this, would be professional judgment. Well, actually, that was fine until somebody came along and said, if you look at the technical actuarial standards, they say, under professional judgment, you must explain the reasons for the decisions you've made. It's the same when I act as an expert witness. If I say, in my judgment, I think this is the view you should take, I have to say, because this, this, and this. So that you maximise the chance of people evaluating your assumptions. And yes, you're always at risk of people, and we do it ourselves, you know, we all have our own everyday biases where we assume that somebody really wants to invite us out for a meal when, because it suits us to make that assumption. But yes, that's an interesting question. Where is the boundary between your communication of information and the responsibility for the other person's decision?
Should we say, here are two assumptions, or whatever, you could take 12 assumptions here. Let us know which one you think is most reasonable, then we'll go work it out, rather than, here are the 12 assumptions you can make, we worked out all the 12 conclusions, which one do you want?
Yeah.
Now that again is a game medical statisticians play.
Yeah.
We know that if we give people the answer, they'll come up with an explanation. So the classic for me was with epilepsy. But broadly, two classes of epilepsy, generalized and partial, and two very common drugs. We'd got all the data together, my colleague had done the summary, and when we presented the results to the two neurologists, what Paula actually said was, there is an interaction between the drugs and the epilepsy type. And she didn't say which it was. She said, what do you think of that? And David Chadwick came back and said, it's really embarrassing because I'm the one who doesn't remember. Well, we've always thought that carbamazepine, carbamazepine is better for partial and valproate is better for generalized. I mean, I can't remember which way around it is, I'm afraid. But he came back saying, we've always thought this without being told it, and that was the way it was. So you're right. Very often it's a staged thing. What assumptions are plausible? Or, you want an accurate answer, are you prepared to spend this much in getting the data? If not, you know, so the Department for Transport's busy saying, we want you to get a completely accurate answer on this, but we don't want you to use a randomized controlled trial because we've got our sums wrong, it's going to be too expensive. Well, you've got a choice. You can have the right answer or not. But you're not going to get the right answer if you just take a convenient sample of people. Sorry.
Ted, your second
okay,
point.
Since we're on assumptions, there's a example which goes back into the classic days of modern statistics, which is Ari Fisher having a look at Mendel's plant breeding experiments. And essentially it's a multi-way tape affair, but the underlying situation on which the model is based, if you state it in logical terms, and this is the important word, you have a class of categories, 1 to k. You have a collection of objects. All of the objects are sought amongst the categories independently of each other and according to certain probabilities. And the probabilities are also stated, so there are three assumptions there. A, the probabilities, B, independence, C, that the assortment is the same for each item of this population that drops into categories. Now, under a normal type of chi-squared test, it is usually a test of goodness of fit of the model on the basis of a hypothesis testing procedure upon which you reject the model if the probability of a measure of discrepancy like the chi-squared statistic is sufficiently small. So say if the p-value is less than 0.95 or less than 0.99, that is strong evidence against your null hypothesis. And your null hypothesis, of course, is A and B and C. A and B and C imply the distribution on the measure of discrepancy. So if you reject that null hypothesis on the basis of the measure of discrepancy, like the wrong numbers in the assortment, that is evidence against B, which is the statement of the equal probabilities, or which is the statement of the probability values. But now, and this was Fisher's point, what do you do if you get a p-value of 0.99? The actual measure of discrepancy you get was 99% likely to be exceeded if your A and B and C were true. Now, this is not evidence against the distribution of probabilities because you've got close agreement. Now, the negation of A and B and C is not A or not B or not C.
Which one?
Which one? Well, B stays put because it's agreed with. And when you go through it, the one remaining thing that has to be rejected is that they did not assort independently of each other. And Fisher concludes that Mendel fudged his data to obtain agreement with his inheritance hypothesis.
I think that is one of the things that certainly quite some time ago now, but quite a number of years ago now, I got involved in a couple of committee papers on detecting fraud.
Yeah.
And I think that's the other side of it. I mean, the other point that would come up from that kind of thing is the difference between absence of evidence and evidence of absence, which is a pet phrase of statisticians, saying there's no proof that this is harmful is not the same as there is proof that this is not harmful.
Exactly. Yeah, so you know, there is a sense in which too good to be true is a valid conclusion.
Yeah.
And it has quite different implications. It's a different rejection of the null hypothesis. But the importance there is it's an illustration of the vital importance of fully stating all the necessary components of the assumptions that you make to apply a model.
If a more robust code for professional mathematicians and their AMAs were to be developed, would there be any important additional points that you think would need to be included outside of versions of the ISI ethic codes that are analogous? Would there be any points that pertain specifically to mathematicians as a whole?
I do have a bit of sympathy with the idea that the purer you go in mathematics, the more likely that the most relevant considerations are the ASA code, which is essentially a commitment to accuracy and truth, which needs to be supplemented by the fact that you are not living in isolation, you are living within a context. So I'm not sure I would push anything very different. I would say it'd be pretty much the same. I can't think of a good reason, but it's a nice question. We can maybe see if we can tease out a nice counterexample to demonstrate why we should.
A counterexample of what?
Just to see if there's any way of saying there is something that ought to be in a code for mathematicians that hasn't already been picked up in the codes for statisticians, recognizing the sort of difference between the two.
Right.
It's a nice little teaser to try to think through. What might be missing?
Can I ask another question?
Yeah.
So the code of ethics that already exists for mathematicians, as you're saying, seems to really focus on sort of pure mathematicians and academics. Maybe part of the problem is that, you know, unlike in statistics where you recognize that statisticians can be many fields and quite applied in like important fields like yours where they're directly going to affect someone. Maybe there should be a code that sort of is for working mathematicians, you know, people who, for example, are in some companies and you can get accredited as a working mathematician and you have to follow some binding code. Maybe that would be...
That would be interesting, actually, just to think through a bit more, I think, where there are. And again, that's where I think if you did, then you would probably have things, for example, saying, working mathematicians in engineering firms should also be aware of this, working mathematicians in banking should be aware of that. And so there's probably a scope for you to develop that, or you and your colleagues to think about that and develop it. Yeah.
Can I do my third one?
Yeah.
Sorry, is there somebody else there?
Is there anyone else who has asked fewer than three questions?
Because otherwise, I mean, we could always have a discussion over tea and coffee or drinks. Is it a quick one, too?
It is a quick issue.
Well, it is fairly quick, yeah. It's a question of the use of particular kinds of statistic to represent, say, social things like income. And the official definition of poverty, if I remember the proportion right, is if you have an income which is below 40% of the median income of the whole population.
I think those sorts of definitions and so on are worthy of a very much longer discussion,
yes,
because they do come into sustainable development.
That has some very striking implications.
Yes. Yeah.
Because if you were to take everybody whose income was above the 40% and below the median and move them all down until they were just above the 40%, you could neither change the median nor the poverty line. You also now have quite a lot of money in your pocket, which you can use to lift all of the people below the poverty line into that middle band.
The basic thing is that...
So that,
yeah,
you know, you haven't...
Who was it
you've eliminated poverty.
Yeah.
Mathematically.
And
that
you've probably
was
got
learned
some money
to
left over,
not to the point of
falsification.
Yeah. No. I mean, I think the... It does come back to mathematics, because obviously mathematics is successful... Because initially you make a problem much simpler so you can solve it, and then you make it more complex again. And obviously that's true with statistics. You try to reduce everything to one number from a distribution, it's going to be misleading. Just as if you try to reduce all of your mathematics to, you know, only using linear solutions to problems, you'd be very misleading. I think that's a fairly generic comment.
I'm reminded of Michael Gove when he was Minister of Education, who came up with that timeless line that I think we should remove, let no one be ignorant of geometry, enter here. We should remove that from above the entrance to maths faculties, and quote Michael Gove that he wanted all students at all schools to be above average.
Yeah.
To be fair, he wasn't the only one, the first ref or something like that. But yes. Having said that, we finish on the legs. Everybody has above the average number of legs.
Almost everybody.
Almost everybody.
Mm. One or two of less. Are we done? We're done. Okay, let's thank Jane again.